Hey, what's up, everybody? Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Let There Be Talk. It is Monday, July 24th, Metal Monday. How are you guys? All good? You have a good weekend? Was it action-packed? As my buddy used to say back in the day, action-packed. Yeah, man, doing good. Just chilling here at the hut, getting the day started. It's been not too hot over the weekend. It's about 85. It's LA. That's pretty nice. 85. And had a good weekend of comedy. What'd you guys do? Did you guys go out there and tear it up? Did you guys tear it up? Did you party until you forget about everything? Fucking today, just going, oh God, back to work. I fucking work every day, man. It's like I worked all week and I did comedy all night, you know, every night, and then podcasting during the day. No days off here. I don't want a day off, actually. My brain starts to fucking go to dark places when I got a day off, you know, sitting around, start to think like, what the fuck? Anyway, yeah, man. We had a what we have on Friday. We had the 30-year anniversary of Guns N' Roses' masterpiece, Appetite for Destruction. And I thought about doing a podcast on it, but then I was like, "Meh, I can't talk about that record again, man." I mean, I've talked about it for 30 years straight, every day. I just start sounding like a robot, you know. But yeah, the record's obviously monumental to me and probably a top five record ever played in my life on cassette tape and vinyl and digital download or whatever format I've had it in over the years. But I do have the original cover with the Robert Williams painting with the original sticker inside. All on vinyl, and I put that thing on Friday and then just posted tons of photos of my love of Guns N' Roses. Of course, absolutely monumental band, and a lot of back and forth on Twitter over what is the best debut record of all time. Is it Van Halen 1? Is it Appetite? Is it Zeppelin 1? You know, thank God we can have that argument, meaning that people have put out masterpieces on their first record and talk about, you know, fucking digging yourself a hole for high watermark. You put out Appetite or you put out Zeppelin 1 or Van Halen 1 and then, you know, people are like, this is a masterpiece and that's your first record. You got to put out, how are you going to beat your masterpiece, you know? A lot of people were knocking the Illusion records. Of course, you know my love of the Illusion records. I did a full episode on it. No need to talk about that. But there is a, you know, a healthy argument there over which is the greatest debut record of all time, which is, it's a tough call. Van Halen 1, to me, is definitely a masterpiece. And everything about it is great. I think on Van Halen 1, let me look real quick here. Van Halen 1, I don't skip any tunes on Van Halen 1. You know, let me get a look at this real quick here. I know the tunes inside and out, but, you know, Running with the Devil, Eruption, You Really Got Me, Ain't Talking About Love, I'm the One, Jamie's Crying, Atomic Punk, Feel Your Love Tonight, Little Dreamer on Fire. Yeah. I mean, what the fuck? You know, I was reading this as I look at the Guns N' Roses, you know, song list here. I know them inside and out. I just want to fucking, I don't want to get the order wrong, even though I do know it. Here we go. Appetite, Welcome to the Jungle, of course. It's So Easy, Night Train, Out to Get Me, Mr. Brownstone, Paradise City, My Michelle, Think About You, Sweet Child of Mine, You're Crazy, Anything Goes, Rocket Queen. I skip a couple songs on this record. And I just read this great article in the LA Weekly. You can find it online with Tom Zutaut. This guy does not do interviews, and he did one on the LA Weekly this week. And hats off to the LA Weekly. I got to give my shout out to them. They covered each day. They were covering great stuff about the Appetite record, and it was fantastic stuff. Like they mentioned, they did a great story on West Arkeen, who is co-wrote some great, great songs, including It's So Easy, but my favorite, Yesterday's, on the Illusion Records. Anyway, Zutaut was saying that he was fighting to get Reckless Life onto Appetite. And that kind of blew my head off. It was the fact that I didn't know about Appetite, which I thought was pretty fucking cool. I was like, oh my God. Even though I already knew the song, I worshiped the EP. I loved it. You can ask my buddies, all my buddies. I was shoving it down their throat. Even my man Mark Baker was like, I bought this on your recommendation. It sucks. You can have it. And he moved on to you too. I still remember it. Gave me the EP on cassette for free. Thank you, Mark Baker. Anyway, can you imagine if you move Reckless Life into the spot of Anything Goes? Because I think over the years, Anything Goes is a throwaway tune to me. And one thing I really found interesting was Zutaut felt that Think About You was the masterpiece song, and he fought to have that song second in the order, which is an amazing story. Think About You instead of It's So Easy. But then he described why they picked the sequence of Welcome to the Jungle, It's So Easy, Night Train, because they wanted to have that punk rock feel, that street gutter thing, and even go into Out to Get Me. If you look at the first five songs, it's such a fucking punch in the face. It's unbelievable. And if you moved, like I started fucking around over the weekend with my own sequence. If you moved Paradise City with My Michelle, you would go, Welcome to the Jungle, It's So Easy, Night Train, Out to Get Me, Brownstone, My Michelle. Fuck, you wouldn't even be able to, you know, pick yourself up after that fucking knockout Muhammad Ali style. You know what I mean? But the sequencing is such an amazing thing with records back in the day. And I still can't believe if you had Reckless Life on there, wow. Take Anything Goes, take that off and put Reckless Life in. Into Rocket Queen? Oh my God, man. You know? Anyway, there it is, you know, 30-year anniversary, and it's tough to call what is the greatest debut record, but I am proud to say that I will take, you know, I mean, even, you know, you can look at a lot of stuff. People were hitting me left and right with records. One guy was like, I know he was trying to push my buttons on Twitter. He's like, what about Icon and fucking Rat? And it's like, come on, dude. You're going to put that up against Appetite for Destruction? or Van Halen one? Some people were saying the first Ozzy Blizzard. I don't really count that because Ozzy had been in the game for years. It is a masterpiece record, Blizzard of Oz, don't get me wrong, but I don't count that as a debut, you know? It is a debut with that band, yeah, but it's not a debut of Ozzy. So yeah, just thank God we got amazing debut records. I fucking love the Strokes debut record, you know? I think that thing's a fucking smasher. There's a lot of great debut records, and then there's the masterpiece debut records, which are Appetite, you know, Van Halen one, and Zeppelin one. And it's tough to even call, you know, Zeppelin one, you know, got the covers on there and stuff. Anyway, thank you. I was a little disappointed with their 30-year anniversary concert. I'm not going to lie. They sounded great. and Guns N' Roses. I mean, man, if you watch Rocket Queen from there, the intro jam, which, by the way, people were asking me what my favorite song is off of Appetite. It's always been My Michelle with a combo Rocket Queen. The groove on Rocket Queen and the fucking lyrics are unbelievable. But My Michelle was so haunting and dark. Just the way that thing comes in, man. Fuck. Anyway, the band sounded amazing at the 30-year anniversary. I did have an opportunity to go, and I decided not to. I've seen this band, let me tell you, I've seen this band a zillion times, and right now I get off on doing comedy so much that I'm like, if it's going to steer me off of the path of comedy, it's got to be something that I haven't seen or it's a must see. And the Apollo, yeah, that's cool. They played the Apollo, but I saw them back in the day, you know what I mean? Early on. So it's never going to fucking surpass that to me. So, yeah, cool that they did the Apollo, and hats off. But I was disappointed that they did not change the set list and they didn't do anything special. I was pretty blown back by that, actually, and disappointed. Look, I love this band. You guys know I love this band. So this is in no way some kind of knock. But come on, what the fuck? You doing 30-year anniversary and you don't do something special? Now, everybody that was expecting Izzy and Steven Adler, you're out of your fucking mind. Do you understand what's going on right now? Is the next day they announced massive more dates, like 3 at the Garden, 3 at the Forum, all over America. There's no way... No way they are going to bring out the original guys if the dudes weren't going to be in permanently, because that would ruin the next day's ticket sales. People would be like, "What? Wait a minute, Izzy and Adler aren't going to be on the tour?" And that would, you know, that would completely ruin that. So there's no way they're going to touch that. So just get that out of your mind. And, you know, I don't think that'll ever happen until this runs its course. Axl's a genius. He ran this band for many years, just himself. Then he adds in Slash and Duff. They're doing arenas, football fields, stadiums, all that. When that starts to fade down, maybe we move another guy into the slot. Reselling of the tickets. Longevity of the brand. And so on and so forth. But I knew they weren't going to bring out the dudes. But I thought at least that they would come out and play Appetite in the sequence, in order. I mean, that to me, at least do that. But not what I really was hoping they would do. If you're an artist and you want to look at things like what would be cool... It would have been cool if they stepped on that stage and did the Night at the Ritz set list all the way back to when it first punched everybody in the face on MTV. That would have been fucking cool. And not even say anything. Just start playing, and then the real people in the crowd would be like, holy shit, this is the Night at the Ritz fucking set list, you know? But then you can look at it also as like, why look backwards? We did that already. Why would we do that again? So there's an argument for everything, and I'm not in the band, and whatever they want to do, fucking hats off, man. At least we got that band out there with a few of the guys, and they're fucking giving it their all, and they sound great. You know, so like I always say, promote what's great, not what you hate. But once in a while, you got to fucking get a little bit of a, you got to criticize a little bit. You got to poke it. You got to poke the fucking sleeping dog. Hey, poke. You got to poke him. Anyway, There you go, 30 years. I love you guys. This episode is brought to you by Earthquaker Devices. If you play music and you play an instrument, you're going to need yourself some kind of stomp box, some kind of pedal. Right now, they got save 30% on all select merch. Not on all, on select merch. And they got amazing pedals, man. You want to sound good? You want to be rocking? Get yourself an Earthquaker device. Check it out. Get yourself a Hummingbird or a Park or the, what is this one? Organizer. You want to organize your riffs? Rainbow Machine. Yes, EarthquakerDevices.com. Handmade pedals in Akron, Ohio. Boutique pedals. I love these guys. Been a sponsor for almost fucking 4 years, man. Insane. Insane. I was thinking about it, how long I'd been doing the podcast. And I thought it was coming up on 5 years, and I found this photo of me, Burr, and Ian, which is from like the third episode or something, and it was over 5 years ago. So this fucking thing has been going on over 5 years, and it looks like some people are just starting to find it. So thank you, man. I've been out here pounding doors for 5 years, and some people are finally opening it. Right on. Also sponsored by my motorcycle sponsor. You know them, El Cajon Harley. Summertime, you need yourself two wheels. Get yourself a Harley Davidson from my great sponsor. Over a year now, these guys have been sponsoring. And I went and saw Guns N' Roses with these guys. They love rock and roll and comedy. Me and Greg Riley went and saw Guns N' Roses at Dodger Stadium. Had the best fucking time. Right now, April through August, they got the bikes, bands, and bikinis first Saturday of each month. They're also giving away some Metallica tickets, I believe. Go on the website and find out about that. ElCajonHarley.com. They got the brand new Harley Davidson Road King special there. Love that thing. Go see the Road King special. All the Milwaukee 8 engines on the brand new touring bikes are on the floor right now. And or check out a breakout or anything. They got great used bikes. El Cajon Harley. Follow them on Instagram, too. They've been putting up some badass photos. I love them. ElCajonHarley.com. Do not sleep. Give them a call, 619-444-1123. Tell them I sent you. Dean Del Rey sent me. I need a motorcycle. Before I get into the episode, I want to give you a little rundown of who is on today. And this guest is great, man. Early 80s. We've got, you know, Van Halen. We've got some, you know, kind of new wave going on. What we have, The Clash has the great combat rock record out. A lot of people argue if that's great or not. I love combat rock. You've got bands like Divinyls, and you got Missing Persons and Wall of Voodoo, Mexican Radio, all kinds of great bands other than rock, man. And it was all fucking dominating on MTV. MTV back in the day was just this great landscape of music. You had all different flavors. There's no format. You'd see, you know, Wall of Voodoo, and then the next video would be Adam and the Ants, and then it'd be Van Halen. You know, it's just incredible how, you know, and you could soak in all this different style of music. And right in the middle of that came a band, a three-piece band that just knocked me out called Stray Cats. And, I mean, this first record, oh, there you go. We could talk debut records, man. They had a smasher with hits, you know. They had great songs. They had an incredible live show. Of course, we all know Rock This Town, but Rumble in Brighton, Runaway Boys, Stray Cat Strut, you know, all on the great Built for Speed record. Came out in 1982. And man, what a band. What a band. And my guest today is the incredible drummer of that band, Slim Jim Phantom. And this guy is the real deal, man. I had no idea about this band's story. I just thought that, you know, they moved to L.A. from somewhere and somehow miraculously got a record deal in the off the Sunset Strip during that, you know, early hair rock scene coming up, you know. But they didn't, man. They started in New York. They fucking punched their way around, moved to the U.K., And this guy's story is great, and I love him, man. And I love this record. Go back and put on Built for Speed. Perfect record for just driving around and relive the glory, man. These guys did something. They made some fucking noise, man. And I saw him at the US Festival, another one of my US Festival alumni's. And I can't thank Slim Jim enough for doing the show. Gonna get into the episode right now. You guys are gonna love it. Don't forget to follow him on Instagram and also follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for all my updates. Oh, the podcast is finally on Google Play and also Amazon Alexa TuneIn Radio. So there you go, guys. You people that have been asking for Google Play, it's there now. Thank you, my boy Ari Manis, for helping me out on that. I got a new website coming up this week, too. So the website will finally be fucking all current with tour dates. There'll be a store for shirts and everything. And that's going to be the one-stop shop for everything that I do. The podcast, tour dates, photos, everything. Upcoming dates before I go, Toronto this week, I will see you. I'm coming with Red Band and Sam Tripoli, 26th through the 29th. We'll be at the Corner and the Underground in Toronto doing shows every night, four nights. August 10th through the 12th, Punchline in San Francisco with Joey Diaz. New York City, I'll be there for a month, August 13th through September 5th, mostly at The Stand. Check my Twitter and Instagram for other shows in New York. I'll be there for a month. Do not sleep. Brea Improv, headline in one night, September 6th. October 4th through the 8th, I'll be in Edmonton, Canada at the Comic Strip. And in Iowa, November 2nd at the Surf Ballroom, the last spot Buddy Holly played. I'll be there with Bill Burr. Thank you, guys. If you want to donate to the podcast, it's patreon.com/DeanDelRay. Right now, let's get the candles lit. Here he is, Slim Jim Phantom. All right, here we are, another episode of Let There Be Talk. Fantastic guest today, man. Introduce yourself. This is awesome.
Slim Jim Phantom.
Slim Jim Phantom, man.
Sherman Oaks resident, neighbor of Dean Del Rey.
Yeah, I can't believe it. You're the first guy ever to bring your dog.
Oh, yeah.
You got a dog, man. Bandit. He's cool, man. I want a dog, you know. How are you, bud?
Yeah, fine. Everything's, you know, pretty good, really.
So great to have you on. It's funny because I saw the Stray Cats two times in my life. And I think about it all the time. One was the US Festival.
Right.
Which I want to try to somehow do a documentary on that thing.
Wow.
You know, I think it's one of the most iconic cuts. It goes Woodstock to me, and then all of a sudden they talk Coachella, but there's this big hole, like one of the biggest, it's almost like a ghost in the concert industry.
I mean, getting the rights from Apple should be pretty easy for you.
Right.
It was one of the, like, we'd done festivals before, and there's been festivals, but I think that one was somehow, you know, a little bit maybe the first festival of the digital age, or, you know, and, like, it's not, in the big scheme of things, that long ago, but if you look at a picture from it, especially the Stray Cats, we have one drum, one guitar amp, and one bass amp, and it's like a giant stage, and there was just a hanging wood cutout that said US Festival 83 and a rainbow.
Yeah,
there
that was
no
it.
Screens. There was no multimedia.
Yeah,
and this is Apple, you know, and a lot of famous bands played there. Bowie was on, I think, one of the days. U2, like people who had known for some of the biggest
the
shows
fucking
ever.
Clash.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the Clash's last show.
Yeah,
we were
Mick there.
With Jones.
That was right before us, yeah.
And also Wall of Voodoo, last show with, you know.
The bands were so good. If you go back and watch it now,
yeah.
How good is Missing Persons? Like, as good as anybody ever,
yeah.
You know. But somehow it got a little bit, I think because it wasn't beaten to death in the time, it was kind of a passion project. For,
yeah, Steve Wozniak.
Yeah, who we met for 2 seconds. But it wasn't. I mean, it was something that he wanted to do, and yep. Supposedly he lost money, but maybe he made it all back now with the rights. It's been on TV a little bit, I think.
Yeah.
But it's a truly iconic kind of classic. Well, very proud to be part of it. Thing,
look at those lineups. You know, when you think about it, it's like. You know, now when you go to a festival, let's say a Coachella, they'll have 3 headliners,
right.
One on each day, and then they'll have a couple of big bands right underneath them, and then the rest is just like a barrage of like yeah. Bands that probably won't be around in a couple
sure.
of years, you know? When you look at that, you know, those days, you know, I mean, you know, it's like Divinyls, NXS,
yeah. All my friends
Cats,
still, too.
The Clash,
funny.
David yeah. Bowie, Stevie Nicks. You know, Wall of Voodoo. Like, I mean, it's
Missing Persons, Men at Work. Like, the yeah. One thing about when I watched every band, regardless of how big they got or still, you know, you could name at least one, probably 2 of their songs.
Yep.
And hum it on a game show.
And their
if
band
someone
members.
Had to,
you could
someone
name
had
a band
to tell
member,
you.
Probably.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So, in that regard, it's a little different. Maybe it's more about songs back then. That's what I would say about the 80s, even if you don't like a few of the, you know, you know, the hair choices or the, you know, the clothing or whatever. Like,
yeah.
It was still very much about a pop song.
Yep.
Like structured kind of pop song with a hook, which is, I, you know, I love rockabilly music. I love all sorts of music. But pop music is, you know, it's they've all got to be in tunes or none of us are here talking, you know.
You're absolutely
30 years
you're
later.
Absolutely right. I mean, that's what I say over and over and over. You know, it's like, well, today's the 30-year anniversary of Appetite for Destruction, and a lot of times, well, people will try it. Like today, I posted up the greatest all-time debut record ever. You know,
right.
That, in my
up
eyes,
there.
I mean, yeah, you could be up there with like Zeppelin 1 and Van Halen
positively.
1. You know what I mean? Even the Boston record. But my point is, when people try to wrangle in like a bunch of other bands, like what about this or that? I go, you're trying to wrangle something in with like 10 great songs with a band that had 1 song or maybe
sure.
or was popular for a vibe or a
yeah.
moment, you know?
Yeah.
That's insane. But really, it comes down to songwriting.
Yeah, positively. A good tune that's memorable. GNR, it's like, I don't know. I went to their show, their pals, and for a long time, and I knew all the songs. And
yep.
It's like, for me, 100 years later, there's been 10,000 songs in and out of my brain. And like their album tracks, I remember them as well. Like it was so that's this, for me, the test of time. If you can hum along to, Nobody Walks in L.A., you know, everyone knows the song. So
yeah, absolutely.
Let alone some giant band like GNR. It's
the
so
other
that was good about us festival.
The other time I saw you was Calaveras County, the Frog Jump Festival.
Okay.
You remember that? They used to do this festival, Bill Graham would put them on, up in Calaveras County where they did the famous frog jumping contest.
What year was that?
I don't know, it was like right there in 83 also
okay.
or so, right around there. And, you know, because I seemed to be seeing you two, Stray Cats, they were all floating around at that
time.
Was it
part of the same tour? Because I remember that summer was... I mean, Us Festival was, of course, a big part of it. But that summer, we did a lot of stuff. And Tom Petty was on a bunch of it.
Right,
maybe,
right, exactly. Tom Petty was the headliner.
Maybe you too. Maybe, like, yeah, so, and like everyone, I mean, I hope young people have the same, you know, experience. But everyone was very friendly back then.
Yeah.
And again, it's like we all have the same job. But, you know, all ball players are friends, I think, when they meet up after the game. And it's,
right,
yeah.
right.
So I remember that summer as being very, you know, kind of rock star and very, you know, backstage passing and stopping in to see that one, stopping in to see that. You know, it was very, very, very friendly.
Yeah, yeah. Now, to me, it's weird to think about it because I just did some research on your band and I had no idea that you guys... First of all, came from New York, and you
yeah.
started in 79.
Yeah.
What I thought, and this was my early, you know, memory of your band, was before the Viper Room, it was called the Central Club.
Yeah.
And I remember you guys would be playing there. Am I right on this?
Yeah, we used to go there. That was one of the original jam nights, Tuesday at the Central.
Right.
I used to go with Brian and guys like Tom Petty would come and Jeff Baxter and Al Cooper.
It was I remember this.
Musician kind of after hours, you know, hang out where we kind of play the blues.
It was Chuckie Wise. And it was like, yeah, Chuckie Wise. And it was like a dollar beers and stuff. Yeah. And people would just go there. And it was
right,
like,
and they would lock the door at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
And if you happen to be there on the night that Tom Petty felt like jamming, you were there at 3 o'clock in the morning and, you know,
dude,
Baxter and Tom Petty and these.
Was really my first memory of you guys. And I thought basically you guys were an LA band and somehow magically got a record deal in this era of like fucking, you know, in between punk rock and Van Halen and Motley Crue, which I thought was absolutely incredible if you thought about it. But I didn't even know you did all this groundwork in New York and playing CBGBs and shit, and then you moved to the UK. This is incredible, man. I had no idea the roots of that.
Yeah, we started 79. I guess we were right out of high school, or maybe even, well, yeah, just out of high school. And we just fell in love with rockabilly music. We were all the musician guys in our neighborhood. And
Long Island?
Yeah, Massapequa, Long Island. Home of the Baldwins, Seinfeld. We can go on. It's one of, you know, it's a funky little place.
Wow.
Nobody stayed or went back, but everyone's from there. And we had always played. You know, I had played since I was quite young. And, you know, the other guys are like virtuoso level musicians. And we were always looking for something to do, and through, I guess, the Beatles and the Stones and a little bit of punk rock, rockabilly came onto your radar.
Right.
Who's C. Perkins on the liner notes? Who's C. Berry? Who's, you know, like,
what
so,
about what about the Clash, too? Because they're kind of rockabilly.
The Clash were a little bit, yeah, I don't know if they were so much. I think I might have discovered them after we had kind of.
So you're really into the hardcore, just Elvis, you know.
Well, yeah, that's what we were into at that point, but from like a classic rock background, because again, you're 16, 17 on Long Island, who's got money and access, you know, to a lot of this stuff. It's not on your radar. So we come from a big family of 10 Irish cousins, and we're all hanging. And like one of the girls had like Billy Joel record, or, you know, and I had a cousin, you know, the boy cousin, he had a, you know, Rolling Stones. Like, so you would borrow records, because I was the guy that wanted to play the drums. I would, you know, play to anything. I didn't care. It was a new album. You put the headphones on and you practice along to.
Yep.
It didn't matter really what kind of music it was, as much as it was new. And so then from there, I think my cousin had Blind Faith, and there's like a Buddy Holly cover on that. Who's B. Holly kind of thing?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, the Stones, C. Berry, you know, the Beatles, C. Perkins. Who were they getting? Where are they? So, like, it's just kind of a natural evolution. We had The Who. I think it was Woodstock. Someone had that. And there's Eddie Cochran.
Right.
Summertime Blues. Like, where's this is my favorite song of theirs. Who's E. Cochran?
Right.
And then you do that little bit of research and
pre-internet and stuff. You had to go to the record store.
Oh, yeah, like
store.
A blurry picture and like Sam Goody on Massapequa didn't have.
Going down
it.
The
so
record
like,
store like, yeah, man.
You had to take the train and find some obscure kind of record store
city.
Kind of thing. Yeah, we would go to St. Mark's Place. That was kind
of
the, you know, like the, you know, the destination place. And
still
then,
is. Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
I mean, they still got the punk rock store there.
Sure.
I got a haircut there a couple of days ago. That's just mohawks.
Well,
and shit.
That's my whole story. We found this music and we're getting more into it. And then we found Elvis Presley's first record, The Sun Sessions, which I think if you have to talk about debut albums, there's not even one in the same galaxy as Elvis Presley's first record. That none of us would be here if it wasn't for that one. So we find that, and there's little tiny blurry pictures. And we knew Elvis Presley, of course, but he was an older guy. He had died a couple of years before that, but I didn't know about rockabilly Elvis.
Right.
I mean, how would you? It wasn't really.
That's 50s.
You know, you couldn't find it. There was Ed Sullivan show, but what do? You find someone who had it on a recorder. No one recorded TV. So like we did a little bit, and that's when for me it really came into view. Like this is what I should be doing, and I love this look. I love this. What I thought was the lifestyle of it. What I just loved it, and I took the train to St. Mark's Place, 8th Street. And went to Hair Power, which is in there. There's probably a different one there.
Right.
Got all my hair cut off. And I had my flares on and, you know, a tennis shirt and you know, sneakers.
Just that
and
70s stoners look.
We look like the Brady Bunch, is what I look like, Greg Brady kind of thing. So I walked across the street now with a big pompadour to Trash and Vaudeville.
Yep.
And I got a pair of blue suede creepers. And so now I walked out of there with a haircut, tennis shirt, flared jeans, and blue suede shoes.
Yeah.
Walked a couple doors down to Andy's Cheapies and bought a pair of baggy pants.
Wow.
Gray baggy pants. So now I had a tennis shirt, baggy pants. I was almost there.
Yep.
Walked down a couple stores more, and there was a place called Cheap Jack's, and I got a black and white bowling shirt.
Wow.
And it was complete.
You just
and
one, I left one all city my block. Song.
I just left all my clothes in the dressing room and my hair on the floor across the street and took the train back to Massapequa and just like, of course you caused a stir.
Yeah.
Looking like this now, and I didn't want anyone to know. The first thing I went over to Brian's house, he and I started to share this little flat. And Lee was my friend, and you know, he played bass, and so we just started to play right away. And we played. We couldn't get into the rock clubs because it was still pretty much like the guys who were wearing the flares and the long hair. So it was hard to get in, and we weren't even punk rock. There was no template for it. It was pretty weird.
Right.
The three of them. And we just found alternative venues, bars, old man bars, you know, that had a plug in the back, no stage.
So, yeah.
And we just loved this music at getting. Dressed up for each other and for yourself and kind of and like learning all these songs. And we just played five nights a week, four sets a night in Belmore and Massapequa, Amityville, like all these towns along our...
And you're just playing 50s covers?
Yeah, we just... Every Buddy Holly, every Johnny Burnett, every Jerry Lee Lewis, every Carl Perkins, every Buddy Holly. We just learned every song and that was our life. And, it was pretty cool because we lived... how we thought Elvis Presley would have lived in Memphis, 1955. You slept late, you went to the diner, you went to the record store,
you
were trying to find black and white shoes at some, you know, other side of the tracks, kind of thrift stores. And like, so, we had money, we did okay. But then we wanted more and we started to hear about the Sex Pistols. And it was a little bit after that, but King's Road in general, and there were Teddy Boys in England and punk rockers. And we really wanted to be birds of a feather somehow. We knew that we could make a living somehow, but what are you going to do in Massapequa 2 years from now, 3 years from now? So we really, and we did once a month, CBGB's, Max's Kansas City, those kind of places. But
were you playing with anybody big back then?
We would have been fourth on the bill to whatever, you know. No, local nights probably.
Right, right.
Maybe the Heartbreakers one time, that kind of thing. But
right.
But nobody paid attention to us, you know. It was,
yeah, because that's got to be a crazy thing at that time, because if we're looking at like 79, you know, you're punk is really hitting, and then also, of course, new wave starts smashing.
Right, right.
And then here comes three guys from Long Island that look like time machine dudes, you know, because every 10 years or so, a band tries to be rockabilly, you know what I mean?
Sure.
But there was something about you guys that was just, first, Brian Setzer was incredible on guitar.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Your guys, it felt so real. It wasn't, to me, it never felt like, here comes the guys putting on their costumes.
No.
It was just kind of felt like, where the fuck did these guys fall out of the sky? You know what I mean? And that had to be weird, though, if you're just playing all around New York and people are like, what is this? Or was it just a rockabilly scene that people were
into? No, there was no rockabilly scene. We were getting a couple hundred kids a night to all these little tiny bars, but they were, it looked like the movie Dazed and Confused or the Brady Bunch. It was just kids that liked what we did, but nobody looked that way.
Right.
And it was kind of rough. Kids who felt very protective over us in a funny way. We were the local eccentrics, and like we rocked every night, and like we were the little reason why everyone went out every night. And they
it's kind of like Eagles of Death Metal now.
Yeah,
you know, there's such a flag bearer of rock and roll.
Right, right, right.
That when you see it, they are completely engulfed in rock and roll.
Right,
and when you see them, you go like. Well, at first you go, what are these guys about? And then you go, oh, these fucking guys believe it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They believe it.
But we didn't expect or want or need. It didn't really matter to us that the audience looked a certain way. Like, it didn't matter.
Right.
You know, we had regular kids who were coming to see us, and they loved it, and they came every night, and they had whatever lives they had around that. They meet people at the gigs, and they were just, but they weren't rockabilly people, but they were our people for sure. And but we wanted to kind of see what it looked like someplace else.
Yeah.
So we kind of packed up.
That's one-way ballsy. Tickets,
no money, no phone call, no. We got to London with, like, you know, pink jackets and a double bass in tow, and like, okay, now what? Well, you said it was a good idea. No, you said it was a good idea.
And you just land on the street with nothing?
Exactly.
Like no apartment or gigs or anything?
Nothing.
This is balls out. I love
it.
I mean, that's going for
it. So we would get like a local newspaper, or like, you know, we had, we knew about the NME, that we had like,
yeah,
old copies of the music papers. Like, London was very big. Like, music is still very important there. Like, I think every kid has a certain age where they're very affected by the music of the time. Like, they're a rockabilly, or they're a Ted, or they're a punk, or they're a, yep, skinhead, or they're a rocker kid, or they're a heavy metal kid. Like, whatever it is, at some point it's a big identity.
Absolutely.
And people grow out of it, and a lot of people stay in it. But like, in England, more than here, I think you're going to get one goth kid maybe in your class, and you know, that's, you know, it's not still,
yeah, yeah,
it's still not as an important, you know, cultural you know, step as it is there. So we would just look at the newspapers and see where there was a band that we thought we could get in for free, or it looked cool, or there was, you know, starts at 2 p.m. And like, and we lived, it was a summertime, and like, England didn't rain for a change. And we lived in Hyde Park. We lived on chaise lounge, you know, lounges, very kind of
just living
up
in
a little
park?
Bit of a mentality. Certain nights, yeah. And we would crash. We met people at parties, Sid and Nancy World, that kind of, you know, squat house. And there was a bunch of times that we would go to like, to X-rated theaters, because you could go in the afternoon and pay, you know, $2 and stay there for 24 hours.
Wow.
You know, we were sleeping in them. So it was all that. And but it was very much the band and gang mentality. And all we wanted was a couple of chances. And then finally we knocked on enough doors, hung out enough places. We looked outrageous enough that someone who booked these pubs would say, okay, next Sunday you can go on at 4:00 p.m. There's 5 bands that night, whatever.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you guys the Stray Cats at the time, or Tomcats?
I think we'd probably become Stray Cats. Yeah, but we were called Tomcats in New York.
Right.
So we would play a couple of gigs, 4:00 p.m, 5 other bands on, and there was, you know, 10, 12 people that we had met at these parties that we were like, you got to come see us. We're the greatest band. And no one had any, all right, maybe we should go see these guys.
Still only doing covers.
No, we had written Rumble in Brighton. We had Rock This Town and Stray Cat Strut. We had those in New York.
Wow, you had 3 of the greatest tunes, yeah, on Built for Speed.
And when we got to London, we wrote Runaway Boys.
Those four tunes.
Yeah, yeah, that's the one I think that changed rockabilly, that song.
That's incredible. So, I mean, Rumble in Brighton, Runaway Boys. Yeah. I mean, those two are fucking smoking, man.
So they were peppered into a set with, you know, the most rockin' Johnny Burnett, Carl Perkins. Gene Vincent was our favorite, probably. So the 10, 12 people that turned up at 4 p.m. that we had been bugging, all right, we better go see these guys. You know, maybe they're great. Maybe they'll shut up. Maybe they'll go home. Maybe they'll, because we were selling all the time. New York,
yeah,
guys, we're,
yeah,
the greatest band.
Are you playing the cocktail kit at that time?
It wasn't a cocktail kit, but I was at the front of the stage. We did that in New York. That was part of what we had, our vision for a new thing. No one, there had been small drum kits that might have been, now I've seen some photos of other people standing up. Never, yeah, that I knew
Jellyfish
about.
Jellyfish were
then.
Copped it later on.
Yeah, yeah, great band.
Yeah.
But no one had put the drums in the front of the stage with no back line. It was just 3 guys right across the front and standing on the drums and doing our act. So the 10, 12 people that came out to see us at 4:00 p.m. were Lemmy, Chrissy Hine, Strummer, Matt Locke. These were all the people that we had met,
wow,
at these parties that we had been hanging around.
Wow.
So, and then by the second gig, Chrissy Hine's boyfriend was Ray Davies, and she brought him to one of the shows.
Wow.
And then Matt Locke brought Paul Cook. So like, at some point, you've got like 20 people in the audience.
You got the Pretenders,
yeah.
Clash, fucking,
and we had now
Motorhead.
Like a bit of a legendary run around like maybe 10, 12 shows around London. And we weren't even the headline band at any of these shows, but we were packing them in. And Jeff Beck came, and then one night the Rolling Stones all came and sat at a table. And
wow.
Like, and so it caught fire pretty quickly in the press that, like, this is what these guys have. We were built in story. They're from New York. They have nowhere to live. The Rolling Stones are coming to their gig.
Right.
They've got four or five original songs. It's Rockabilly 2000.
Yeah.
It's modern rockabilly. And we just kind of took it from there. We were lucky enough to meet with Dave Edmonds, who became the producer, who really knew what he was doing and loved it and got us right away, and he produced the first record, and we kind of were off and running.
That's incredible. Now, you do a record over there and it sells like crazy, but you can't get arrested in the States, right?
Well, what happened, and I wouldn't have known that then, now you know it a little bit, there's two kinds of record deals. When you sign a record deal in England,
yeah,
it's usually for the, it's called ex-US, or because a record company doesn't want to bite off the whole world.
Right.
And the same when a band signs a record contract in America, it's usually not including Europe and Australia.
Right, you do
and
a
then
separate
each territory
deals.
Has
right.
the right to release it if they want. Like, if you make a record for Warner Brothers in the US, that's, you know, Warner Brothers Australia, I don't know, it's some band from LA, we don't want to make an investment in this kind of thing until
yeah.
you see what it, so we kind of, I don't good now looking back, we had 2 years that we just played Europe, I don't know how many times, 10 times, and Australia, Japan, all these crazy places, we had big hit records there, so by the time that they decided to release it in the States, we had 2 years of, you know, very good experience that you can't buy
right.
anywhere. Like
yeah.
we were on TV 100 times, and we opened up for a lot of famous people. So we knew the job.
Right.
By the time it comes to, you know, to the States, MTV had just kind of clicked, and it was all kind of game on, and we just did it again. We got back into a bus and did 12, 13, 15 weeks in a row of just playing every burg in America. And then eventually you get to LA, and I got off the bus and I just never left.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I'd been to Paris, I had been to, you know, but I'd never been to LA. It's
right.
a funny thing, you know, we've been to Tokyo, but never Topeka.
That's hilarious.
Paris, but never Pittsburgh. It was a funny, so I'm an LA guy, I just never left. It's 1982 and I just never left.
Now the combined US deal combines both the first two Europe records
yes.
and makes Built for Speed.
Exactly.
That's totally the AC/DC thing. You know, you got the High Voltage and the Dirty Deeds or High Voltage and whatever the other record is, and they combine them.
Right, because they came out of England too. I think they're Australians, right? But they came
right,
out of
right,
England as well.
Right.
Yeah, so it's a similar story.
Yeah, so you know, you got to think about at that time, what year did Built to Speed come out?
82, summer of 82. 82.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, look what's going on around 82. It's Van Halen, you know what I mean? It's Judas Priest, that new wave of heavy metal, you
yeah,
know, British
yeah.
new wave, all that. And then out of nowhere, I mean, you know, what label were we on? Interscope?
EMI.
EMI. For them to put it out and then for, that's the diversity that was going on
yeah.
back then, you know, because you have Van Halen's huge on MTV, but then you got the Divinyls is huge and
yeah.
Stray Cats
yeah.
and all that.
I think the labels, especially for some of those foreign, for lack of a better word, bands, the labels in the States got a little bit of a break, and we fell into that category because regular radio, this would have been June 1982, they were still playing the conventional kind of rock stuff. You
right.
really had one choice, and that was the FM station, and that was that. But MTV had started about a year before, 6-8 months before. It was starting to catch on slowly. And MTV, believe it or not, they needed content.
Yeah.
There just wasn't enough videos,
you're right.
you know? So
it's like Netflix, early
so,
Netflix.
Yeah. So if there was a label, in our case EMI, or maybe the Divinyls, was whatever labels, RCA or Virgin or Warner Brothers or Atlantic, whoever the big labels were, they, hey, we own this. Without
yeah.
really knowing it, they owned it. And they couldn't get it on rock radio because that was still for kind of what we know as classic rock these
right.
days, right? But MTV was an outlet for it, and they needed video. So if you gave MTV 5 videos from 2 Australian bands, and these guys, they're American, but it comes out of England, it, Adam and the Ants were another one, it got played.
Yeah.
And it was just, I mean, if you're a bunch of kids coming home from school every day, turning on this new MTV, because MTV was on cable systems that weren't in every town, so it wasn't an overnight sensation.
You're right.
MTV built up as well. They get accepted by Comcast and then by Time Warner and then some, you know what I mean?
I remember I had to go to my buddy's house in another town over that had it, and I'd stay on Friday night and I'd watch all the videos.
So if you're a kid coming home and turning this on, and you know, you're tired of your older brother's classic rock records,
Boston and all that,
boom, Adam and the Ants comes on, and the Stray Cats and the Divinyls, and like, holy mackerel, you're getting your mind blown, I think, you know. And we were kind of lucky where we fit into a and we had two clips that we had done in England, so the new record company didn't have to make the investment in this.
Right.
They already owned two free videos that came along with us, kind of thing. So so that was getting played the same time you're on tour, and MTV was very mom and pop back then, where if you went to New York, you would just, if you're hanging around the hotel, I don't know, bored, let's go to MTV. Okay, so you'd go over and everyone was friendly. I mean, Martha Quinn's still my friend, JJ Jackson, RIP, Alan, Nina, Mark Goodman. You were friends with these people, so you just go and, hey, you want to go on the air? Sure, let's go on MTV. And it was still kind of like that.
So it's kind of like serious radio now.
So it was a good building thing, and the record companies didn't really have any. They went along with it eventually, but it was, you know, it was very good times because everyone was friendly and everyone was in on the game, and it was all kind of like happening in live time. And we had always been very fortunate because we were accepted by all musicians.
Right.
We weren't some hokey band that played a synthesizer or whatever. We were accepted. So, like, Eddie Van Halen was my friend. And like, you know, we were accepted by these rock kind of god classic guys. And also, we were friends with the Divinyls. We were, like, fit into a very good kind of spot because rockabilly in general... you could be punk rocker, you could be new wave, you could be heavy metal, you could be rock and roll, you could be old school, but everyone agrees on Eddie Cochran, and that's the...
Right.
You know, and we were the symbol of the new Eddie Cochran, you know, we were keeping that going.
Yeah, man, I mean, not only that, but you guys had a live show that was fucking smoking fire, man. I mean, when you guys came on, it was like, kick some ass, you know what I mean? And of course, you know, you had killer tunes and there was just a great scene going on. Now, when the record hits in the States, you guys start touring, who are we opening for?
At that point, we weren't opening for anyone. In the States, we did clubs.
Right.
And we just headlined clubs. You know, we started out with 500 seaters, whatever would be the, you know, the Roxy of every town around America. We just really did it. And then we would open up for certain people. I think we did a bunch of shows with Elvis Costello. We were picked by Willie Nelson to open up.
Willie Nelson.
We fit into that crazy niche as well.
Wow.
Yeah. So we did a little tour with... It would have been Merle Haggard, Waylon Jennings, with Jesse Coulter, David Allen Coe, Willie Nelson, the Stray Cats thrown in there.
That's crazy.
And then we were also on the tour with you know, Elvis Costello and Squeeze, kind of, you know, we were just, it was good because rockabilly, without setting out to do it, you know, purposely, it straddles a lot of fences.
Right. You know? It really does.
So we could be with Van Halen one day and Willie Nelson the next day, and it kind of made sense.
Yeah.
We're the link between it all. Rockabilly is the link between it all.
Now, you know, you guys, you're out there and you start to explode. Do you start to make some good money, or did you have a bad record deal, or what was going on with that?
No, we did okay. I think we probably had a bad record deal, or like everyone had a low royalty record deal because the labels were still in control. You know, now maybe the artists have a little bit more control. But no, we did okay. Everyone led, you know, nice lives from it. So
right,
you know, I stayed in L.A. and I was more than happy to live on a Doheny Drive and have a Corvette. I was, you know, hanging out at the Rainbow, and I was friends with all the guys, the GNR guys, the Motley Crue guys. You know, Steve Piercy from Rat's still my buddy. Like, I was friendly with all those guys because, again, the Stray Cats in any scene were a little bit the odd man out in how we looked and how we, you know, the music. But I was, you know, King Party guy. So I would,
yeah.
I was, you know, I gravitated to the guys that could hang. And
were you guys partying?
I was, yeah, for sure.
What kind of stuff? You into coke?
Ah, whatever. It was the 80s, did everything. I was just high and keeping it all going, and it was a good time. And, you know, a bunch of, right around here, you could do the rock and roll tour. You know, Nikki Sixx's house was right up here.
Yeah, Duff. Yeah.
We were all kind of right around here.
Right, right. Wow, that's crazy. I just had Nikki on a couple days ago. You know?
He's my buddy. I stay in touch with him, too. He never sleeps, does he?
Yeah, right. That guy's a worker.
You know, like we're talking about the GNR guys and the Motley guys. They're all, I mean, everyone's
gone
on to have really, successful, respected rock and roll middle age. I think it's great.
It's really pretty crazy, right? To think about, like, oh, only a few people died, you know? Like when people are like, oh, we're losing all our legends now, I'm like, well, they live to be 60 or 70 is pretty incredible to think how bad you burn it up for, let's say, 70s, 80s into the 90s. You know, I mean, we still got Eddie Van Halen, and that guy burned it up hard, you know? And Lemmy lived all the way to 71?
70.
70,
Yeah. I mean, he's a whole nother show. Yeah. Lemmy was my best pal.
That guy's a pro.
That's a whole nother show.
Yeah, right. Absolutely. I was...
He was a rockabilly guy. He was at those first Stray Cat shows. He was there. Because he loved rockabilly and roots music. He kind of knew more about it than really anyone I had met up to that point. You know, we were rockabilly guys. We were in the Stray Cats. But Lemmy, in his flat, had, you know, reel-to-reel recordings of Gene Vincent off the BBC that he made himself. And, you know, couldn't believe I didn't know these obscure songs by Little Richard. And, you know, he was that guy. So he and I had a friendship, 35 years, you know.
Yeah, I went to his 70th birthday, and you guys were going to play, right? Headcat? I mean, for a second.
The one at the Whiskey. Yeah, they rolled
his amp out, and we were all ready, and then it just didn't happen.
Yeah,
he
was kind of
bad
at that point.
Pretty sad, but, you know.
But we sat with them upstairs, you know. You know, we watched everyone else pay their respects, and that was a really good night.
Yeah, it was, man. That cake was incredible. Whoever made that cake at him, man. I love that guy.
Yeah, he was the best.
You're burning it up, and then and boom, it's over. You know what I mean?
We had about 5 years where it was just nonstop, and everyone wanted a break. And everyone made a solo record. That was a whole other great adventure. I did a solo record with Lee Rocker, and we met a guy who's still my buddy to this day, Earl Slick, who
Phantom Rocker
come,
Slick.
Yeah, and he had just come
I remember out, that actually.
He had just done a Bowie's tour, and he just did John Lennon's last record, and so we were natural guys from New York who really liked each other. So we fell in with Slick, and I think actually Eddie Van Halen had something to do with meeting. We met at the NAMM show. Slick was doing a guitar thing, and maybe Van Halen was there. Said you should meet this guy, and it was all kind of somehow linked, you know. And Slick was a New York guy. His father was a cop. I'm a New York guy. My father was a fireman. So we all kind of like naturally got along together. And then we made a solo, you know, a solo record for Lee and me with Slick, and Keith Richards played on it, and, you know, was able to get in touch with him. And because the Stray Cats had toured with the Stones a couple of years before.
Which tour was that?
We did part of the Tattoo You.
Oh, man. Because I saw the Tattoo You tour, and it was George Thorogood.
Yeah, he did a bunch of shows.
Which is another guy, and then Jay Giles.
He lives around here, too.
Yeah, on the Centerfold tour. But there's another guy, George Thorogood, that was big in that era.
Awesome. He still plays a lot.
Oh, yeah. I opened for him a couple times. Yeah. He was the nicest guy, man.
Yeah, he's a Beverly Glenn guy, too.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Wow. But he... you know, he's big at that era. You know, when you...
The Stones were taking people that they liked.
Yeah,
that
right.
was And, like, those guys at least had record contracts. When we opened in America, the record hadn't been released yet, so we were just along for the ride. And we won the audiences over every night because after the initial shock of, what the hell is this, you know, these guys have... That guy's got an orange cowboy suit on, and he's standing up and playing the drums. What's going on?
Yeah.
But eventually, every night, anyone who likes the Stones, they say, wait a minute. Hey, this is, and it's all like we say, we can all trace it back to Buddy Holly and to Eddie Cochran, right. Chuck Berry, and like, so that was a great experience. So by the time we made a solo record a few years later, I was able to get in touch with Keith Richards, and he was available in New York City. He came and played the, so here I am again. It was another page of the adventure and kind of a cool thing. And then after about 2-3 years, the Stray Cats reformed again.
Right.
So we started playing again in 88, and then had a like a good run. The records weren't giant hit records then, but we continued to make records and we always did well live. And then that went into the 90s, and then we took another break, and then we started up again. We've been doing it like every like 5-7 years, it seems like, since then.
And there was no bad blood?
No, not particularly. It's a very New York thing that when the way that you deal with a problem or like is to just ignore the whole thing.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
You know, just don't talk to that guy for 5 years. And then the phone will ring. Hey, buddy. Hey, what's up? You feel like playing? Yeah, maybe. You watch the Mets game? Yeah, well, you know, I'm a Yankees guy. But yeah, so, you know, it just becomes that.
Yeah.
And somehow we make the right couple calls and there's one offer that you can hang something around, and it seems like it's always, you know, the interest is always there. If I, you know, had a choice to go back and do it all differently, I might have played it differently at certain times in your life. But listen, we're still around here talking about it. You know, if you told me in Massapequa when I found rockabilly music, at 40 years later, you'd be, someone wants to talk to you on the radio, and you'll know all your favorite drummers, you're pals with them, and you know, so.
Yeah, man. I mean,
I'll sign.
You got to look at like what you guys did. I think it's so insane. I talked about it a couple of days ago. I still can't, I can't stress how insane it is of what the music landscape was, and then for you guys to get big in the middle of that. You know what I mean? I mean, this is like, this isn't just like luck. There was multiple hits, there was tours, and Brian Setzer later plays in the Honey Drippers, mm-hmm. and does all his Christmas thing, and then what comes later on is fucking massive. Squirrel Nut Zippers, Royal Crown Review, the big swing revival, and all this, you know? That all kind of kicks off from the Stray Cats.
Oh, positively. And like now I'm a little bit older. Before, I used to be a bit more aw shucks about the whole thing.
Yeah.
But when we started doing it, there were no hot rod festivals. There was maybe some greasers with a couple old cars who played doo-wop music and maybe Blueberry Hill or, you know, but it wasn't a scene particularly. There weren't any tattoo conventions. I think we were the first people that I know of that would have been on national TV with tattoos.
Yeah, besides Bon Scott, you guys were. It was like, whoa, they got tattoos.
And like, we were children. Bon Scott looked like an gnarly guy.
Right.
You know, a biker or a sailor or a convict or you know what I mean? He could have been one of those guys.
Yeah,
but for us,
they got him in the Marines or
like,
our Navy.
We were children and like, it was a little shocking.
Where'd you get the tattoos back then?
We got a few in New York before we left. Because
it was illegal in New York, right?
Yeah. Bob Roberts had to go to his house.
Yeah.
And
wow.
You know, now tattoos, it's hard to find a band that doesn't have a tattoo.
Yeah, right.
You know, there were no tattoo festivals. Now there's open, they're not meeting behind closed doors anymore. Now
it's like Ink and Iron. Then you got that Hootenanny style concerts across America.
None of that stuff really existed before we started doing this. And I'm very happy to be part of it. To take credit for it in a certain extent. But we really ensured that rockabilly music would continue. And I think we made it a little bit of a household term. Whereas when we started, and someone said, "What's your band like?" Well, we like rockabilly. Well, it's like early Elvis Presley. It's the blues meets hillbilly music, but then we like the Sex Pistols and we like punk rock, but we like to mix the... What? Wait a minute. Now if you say someone, "What's your band like?" It's kind of like the Stray Cats. You know what they're talking about.
Right. You are right there.
So I think it's become a little bit of part of the, the terminology of the whole thing.
Right.
I definitely think that we were one of the bands in the past, say, 30 years. If they weren't there, the landscape of the whole thing would be different.
Yeah.
Certainly the Sex Pistols, certainly someone like, say, the Cars, someone like the Police, would the landscape be totally different if these guys hadn't done it? And the answer is yes. I think if the Stray Cats never played, the landscape of rock would look a little bit different.
Yeah, believe that.
Because without even knowing it, like if it's little pieces of fashion or little pieces of the culture, little pieces of... rockabilly culture has kind of seeped into the whole thing.
Well, you know? Even Salsa Distortion really starts to turn into this rockabilly culture, and they kind of start wearing the crown of it and everything.
He helped carry the flag. He's a good guy. Yeah. Mike Ness is my buddy. I'm going to actually see him. We're all on a show together in September. And he did his bit, too, because he's crossing it over. A whole lot of kids got into it via him.
Absolutely.
And his band. So that's what I look for, is like anyone who like pays it forward, you know, and adds their own little twist to it and keeps it all, you know, moving forward.
Yeah.
So guys like Ness and me, now it's up to the young kids. Someone else has got to do it now. And, you know, I can make a living from it, and I've had my stories. You know, now it's up to the next guy to like take Social Distortion and the Stray Cats and mix that with the Police or with the Cars or with AC/DC,
right.
Whoever we're talking about. Like, move it forward.
Yeah,
your own.
I think one thing incredible about like the rockabilly scene, and I've always been mystified by that, like just blown away, especially at a Social Distortion concert. It's a scene.
Oh yeah,
it is. These people are scene. They are into it.
Yeah.
You go to people's houses, they got the dial phone.
Exactly.
They got the high five.
Exactly.
They got the plastic on the couch.
Yeah.
and the
leopard
royal
skin
crown.
Couch, hopefully.
Yeah, leopard skin couch. And almost, I used to make jokes like, you couldn't even date a rockabilly chick if you were a normal.
No.
Were a rocker. It was weird, the lines in the sand. These guys are goth. Those guys are rockabilly.
Yeah.
And those guys are rockers. It was so hilarious to think about.
And
you never mixed.
See, and like, for me, when I first started doing this, there wasn't that much. So, like, when we went to England, part of, I think, why we fit in and were like accepted was that, where we had come from just now, it was kind of a hassle having style.
Right.
To be honest with you, like it was a constant, what are you guys supposed to fucking be? What are you dressed up for? You faggots? This is at 7-Eleven every day, you know?
Yeah.
So that was part of why we went to England. That was certainly in the mix. So when we met punks and mods and, you know, skinheads and, ska guys and, you know, what, you know, those guys were called Grebos, who were into Lemmy and that,
really?
That kind of thing.
Grebos?
Yeah.
I've never even heard that.
Find that one on there.
Wow.
Yeah. But anyway, the three of us individually, especially me, I was like anyone with any haircut and any style against the squares.
Yeah.
So I had a genuine, like, I like everything. There's two kinds of music. I wish I could take credit for it, but Duke Ellington said there's two kinds of music. There's good music and there's bad music. And, you know, I love great reggae music. I love great heavy metal music. I love great rockabilly music. I love great blues music. And the rest of it is, you know. So I was just really into being friends with everyone. I was at the No Sleep Till Hammersmith gig with Larry.
You were there?
I was there.
Holy
positively.
Shit.
Whereas it's not like rockabilly wouldn't be caught dead at a heavy metal concert. See, I'm not like that.
Right.
Because when I started doing this, that didn't exist.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't say, I'm only going to be this.
Yeah.
I wanted to go where the action was, you know, whoever brought the action, you know. So, so I think it's good to be focused in a way, but like it's bad to be focused at the expense of everything else.
I
think if you want to make it as any type of musician or artist, whether it's in fashion or it's designing cars or furniture or a building, you know, whatever you want to do, I think you have to be open to the good stuff from every movement.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, I don't understand people that don't listen to all different music, you know? Like, I'll go from Sade to Zeppelin to Skinner. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because they're all good.
Yeah,
it's not,
to Nick Cave. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think you have to, or you're cutting yourself.
I don't understand people that really don't do that. It's like people that would, you don't just go see one type of movie. You know what I mean? Why do you only listen to one type of music? It makes no sense, you know? It's really crazy.
But the people who are into it are really into it. And I dig it. I like to go to their house to see Leopard Skin Couch. It's all cool with me. But
I love it.
But I also, you know, like other stuff too.
Yeah. I remember I was on tour with the Wallflowers in 2000.
Ronnie Jaffe's one of my best pals.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. I was opening for him in, I think it was 2002, 2003 or something. But every night I would close my set with Stray Cat Strut as Tom Waits. I would sing it in a Tom Waits voice. You know, I'd be like, black and orange stray cat sitting on the fence. Ooh. Every night I did that, man. Just like, it was like a tribute to the two things I loved. I love Tom Waits.
And he's the coolest guy ever.
Oh, my God. And I love that song. So I put them together. You know?
I just got a new story to add to my arsenal.
Yeah. I call them the Tomcats. That's what I call it.
A couple of weeks ago, I was going to New York with my son.
Yeah.
Who's 29 and has really long hair and like loves all his drummery, not rockabilly, you know. So,
yeah.
So we're on the, and we didn't get the TSA check. Oh, man. So we're online, about to take our shoes off.
Yeah.
8 a.m. And you know how they make you go in the maze?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the guy right in front of you is in the line, kind of ahead of you by maybe 10 or 2 because it's zigzagged.
Yeah.
So I'm standing there, and I look up, and I'm looking at this guy, and I know who he is. And he's looking at me like, I think I should know who this guy is.
Yeah.
It's Tom Waits.
Wow.
And I never met him.
What, LAX?
At LAX,
wow.
Yeah. So he so I said, Stray Cats guys. Oh, yeah, of course. You know, so we spent probably 10 minutes walking in the line together.
Wow.
And then he gets to the thing. He goes through. He takes his boots off. I take my boots off.
So yeah.
So then we're back at the recombobulation area, both putting our boots back on.
Yeah.
So, you know, we have a little chit-chat. And then I know that he's close with Keith Richards.
Right.
And that Keith kind of writes songs with him and runs a lot of stuff before he does it through Tom Waits.
Wow.
Is the final like cool filter.
Wow,
you know?
I never knew that.
Yeah. And again, just rock nerds like me would know that kind of thing.
Yeah. I'm a rock nerd. I'm just saying.
I'm putting my shoes back on, you know, my boots, lacing my boots up again next to Tom Waits. I said, so you spoken to Keith lately? He said, you know, he's funny. I haven't spoken to him in about a month. And sometimes he calls and he's there. And like, this is just, you know, 40 years later, I'm at the airport putting my shoes on with Tom Waits talking about Keith Richards as a bro, as an equal, you know? And like, that's it. I'll keep doing it.
That's the barometer right there, right? Yeah. Of cool, man. Man, to me, it's Bone Machine. I just think that record is, I mean, Mule Variations and, of course, all the early stuff, but I really get into Bone Machine, man. That's where it's like, what is this music,
He's
you know?
He's a one-of-a-kind guy.
He is.
But now, again, loves rockabilly and jazz and blues, and you can tell that's where he's coming from. So I think 9 out of 10 bands, he might not know if I say, hey, it's the Stray Cats guy. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So again, it's another part of the debt I owe to rockabilly music that it ticks that box. Tom Waits knows it.
Right,
and
right.
He's, you know, I don't know how many modern rock bands he would really be aware of.
I mean, it's like 5 of the coolest people. You got Nick Cave. You got Tom Waits. I'm talking like, you know, PJ Harvey. As far as the cool barometer.
I totally agree. I don't know those two, but right. I'd like to meet them. I'd like to meet Nick Cave. I'll bet we have a lot of common references, you know.
Now you bike. Did you? You were the owner of the Cat Club. Okay. Now I'm gonna give people a heads up. There was a club right next door to the Whiskey, and they would do these jam nights there. What Starfuckers or whatever?
When
I first moved to LA, I would hang there on a Tuesday. It was a Tuesday, I believe.
Thursday nights.
Thursday night.
Every Thursday for 15 years.
And you would go there and all kinds of people would come in and play in this really, really small little bar. Now, what year do you buy that and how does that happen?
That happened 98, 99. I had some experience in nightclub business before that. We had a place on Hollywood Boulevard.
Oh, you did? What was it called?
It was called Diamond Club.
Oh, wow.
And it was big. It was like 100,000 people. We used to do big dance nights and all that, concerts and all that kind of thing. And then I was out of it because, oddly enough, I was looking for a job because my son was little then, and I didn't want to go on the road.
Oh, wow.
And the Stray Cats would not work, and I didn't want to take a job, go on the road. I was trying to find things that I could stay home.
Right.
And I didn't really know how to do anything. You could do a certain amount of sessions, a certain amount of this, but then you're going to have to go on the road to do. So I got into clubs. It's kind of almost a square job kind of thing because I could relate to it. I could kind of
You can get up late.
Yeah, and you're in the office mainly, and then at night, you know, sometimes you go babysit the club, but usually at night is when the owners are gone. You know, I had a partner, so we would take turns. So then I was out of the club business in the mid-90s, and then I wasn't really interested unless something came up on Sunset Boulevard, because I lived for many, many years right on the Strip.
Where at?
Doheny and Sunset.
Oh, wow, right there.
I lived there 20 years. So,
right by Lemmy.
My house, the back of my house opened onto his little street back there, yeah. So I'd walk my dogs and I'd see Lem's curtain.
Billy Gibbons is up there too.
Yeah, he's right by there as
well. Right.
Exactly. So I moved over here to the country, to Beverly Glen, about maybe 7 years ago.
You like it over here better?
Yeah, it's different. But where I live, they're building this giant thing on the corner there. I don't know. I think you would have got chased out by it, you know.
Oh, on Doheny there? Yeah. Oh, where the old Chevron was.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, I can't believe it, exactly. Man. They're just fucking...
It's all knocked back until my house, which was the third one down.
You
know?
Oh, wow.
It's like, I don't know. It was an old house from the 20s. I don't even know how it's still standing with the...
Wow. You know,
they've dug 500 feet down there and all the way through, and it's... I mean, if you go there, you wouldn't even recognize it. So anyhow, so Cat Club, through just how club land is, you know, someone had a lease that couldn't get the liquor license attached, and I was already approved for a liquor license because I had another club, and it was just a funny string of events, you know, that we wound up there. And I brought what I knew how to do, is we put some equipment in there, and we just started doing bands. And I did bands at the Cat Club for... We did five bands a night, seven nights a week, 15 years.
Wow.
So my punk rock conscience is
five
clear. Yeah.
Was it just one set of gear and the bands just came in and played old Coconut Teaser style?
Exactly. Right. I mean, you couldn't do that much. So I had nice equipment, which was part of what people liked, because I had endorsements and I knew the people at Gretsch and at Ampeg and Zildjian and Gibson and Fender. They were all, I just know all these people for a long time, and they were happy to have their stuff parked there because they knew that it was a good quality musician, and they came to town once a year from where they lived for a NAMM show or whatever, and then they had carte blanche at the Cat Club, and it was just really one of the last places I know of. I just made it like my living room. It's velvet couch and leopard skin carpet, and
I love that section, because you had the whiskey, the Cat Club, and Dukes.
Yeah, it went whiskey, Dukes, Cat Club.
Yeah, exactly. And you would just like Dukes, man. You go in, you get the cinnamon toast.
There you go.
And you hang out, you know. And it was just like, you look over and you go, "Whoa, that's Winona Ryder," or whatever. You know, you're just in there, and it was just, that was like some of the last old Hollywood, you know.
Yeah, you know, it's changed up there. Hopefully, it all revitalized. But I like to think, I don't like to be grumpy old guy, but now I think, it's not quite Sunset Strip, how I knew it. But then I would assume that the guys from the Rat Pack would have said that about me. So hopefully it all kind of regenerates. And I'm very happy about my time I spent there. And I helped organize the first few Sunset Strip music festivals.
Oh, yeah,
and
those
we
are
were
great.
Part of the whole thing. And it really was a community up there. The guys from the Rainbow and the Roxy and the Whiskey and the Viper Room, everyone was friendly and knew each other and would have little meetings about what to do up there. So I was, you know, happy to be part of the...
Now you sold it?
What happened was I had partners who wanted to leave, and these new guys came over. It's an English pub now called Rock and Riley's.
Right, right.
And I stayed on. Just left my shares there, which became much smaller than owning one third of it, you know. But it's just a different scene for me. My son is involved a little bit, it's just for me. I was, you know.
Oh, so you're still part of the owner in there?
Yeah.
Like, oh wow, yeah, because Rock and Riley's always has people in there.
Yeah, it seems like there's more people going to watch Manchester United than ever came to watch punk rock. You know?
Yeah, so, right. And then they've got the place they built right next to it, right? Like another place.
I think they expanded it.
Yeah, they expanded.
And then where
upstairs.
Dukes was, it's a nice restaurant that I think those guys are involved with as
right,
well.
Right, right. Yeah, the Strip is totally different now, man.
Yeah, it's a nice restaurant.
I don't mind it over here. My apartment is incredible.
Fantastic.
But it's a little sleepy, you know?
Well, and Shore Boulevard now is no bargain. It's still hard to get around. And
right. You know. There's some great shit there. Are you a vinyl guy? You got a freak beat?
Sure.
Yeah, you got to be.
Yeah, just right here is my shoe guy and my mailbox.
Yeah,
I keep down here. Just my gas station, my liquor store. It's all on your streets. I'm one block up.
That's crazy, right? You're like my neighbor. That's hilarious. Now, what are you doing? You're getting ready to go on the road.
Well, yeah, the main thing, this last year I wrote a book that's out. That's,
oh, yeah? You know, what is it?
It's called Stray Cat Struts, A Stray Cat Struts on St. Martin's Press. It's like a real book. A lot of the stories we talked about are in there. And I did a year book signings and all that. We did Book Soup and we did the Barnes & Noble down here and all that. And I've done that, really. That was a year and a... I still do gigs a lot, like under my own, like I'd use a trio. I just came back from Detroit and from...
I was just there. Where'd you Windsor play, Smalls?
I played right over the bridge in Windsor, Ontario.
Right. Oh, I got
you. Go back and forth via Detroit. And I did that. And I'm going next week to do some rock fests in Europe. And then I got some odds and ends all through September. I go out and do weekends. I kind of like it a little bit more now, just on my own kind of thing.
Right.
You know, the big rumors of Stray Cats are going to play, so we'll see how
really?
That goes.
Next I need year to see that band rumor. Again.
So we'll see, hopefully.
Yeah. I really
But everyone need to, wants to do it. Let's put it that way.
I need to see Stray Cats again.
I just stay busy. I'm going to write another book, I think, and... You know, maybe do a radio show about rockabilly. So
yeah. Oh,
more things to stay around the hood. You know.
Yeah. Exactly.
I've been to Germany and Australia enough times for a while.
Yeah, it's great to have you on because it's just I think about those, you know, 83S festival in that Calaveras County. It really feels like a whole different lifetime ago. You know.
Yeah, and it was good classic things. And I guess guys our age, we're about the same age, right? So like, you know, someone much younger, much older could care less. But like for our time,
yeah,
these were the kind of the cultural milestones a little bit. And we were part of a few of them. So that's, you know, that's what I'm proud of, is that we were there for a
And you're drumming, man. You were just radical. You're just up there on that fucking bass drum, slamming on the snare and everything. And you know, it was the energy and how electric it was. It's just fucking incredible. Are you beat up from that?
Well, my knees are a little bit less than they were, I suppose. But I play senior softball. I'm the youngest
no
guy
shit?
On the team. Yeah, Sherman Oaks.
Senior softball, I love it.
I played last night, 7 innings.
What position?
Oh, they move me around because I can chase still. You know, I can still run better than the guy who's 80.
Wow. Senior softball.
But, you know, like I stay busy. I'm pretty fit. We exercise every day. We've got a little hike club. We go Franklin Canyon and put myself and, you know, Lazy Rock Stars who are home. And I'm trying to think. It's all pretty good, really. I'm kind of mellow. I kind of, you know, happy to have done a lot of the stuff I did and still be able to make a living from it and have a core group of pals, you know.
Yeah.
And
did you guys split the songwriting? How'd that work?
Some of the songs were written by the three of us, some were written by Brian by himself, some were written by Brian and me, whoever, you know, like everyone's got a little like amount of it. And it's just every now and again it feels right to go do it, so hopefully, you know, soon we'll do it at some point.
Right.
But everyone wants to, so that's the main thing. We'll see what happens.
Where do the other guys live? They live in LA?
One lives in Orange County and Brian lives in Minneapolis. He married a girl from there years ago.
Oh, Minneapolis.
Yeah.
I was just there.
Yeah.
I was doing comedy there, man. I went to First Avenue.
Oh, okay. I went to
Prince's place where he passed and, that bar, you know, Palmer's bar where the Replacement started and all that.
I remember First Avenue. We played and he came first tour.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
Wow. Did you talk to him?
No. But I know he was there. I know for a fact that he was there, and I know that he liked it.
Yeah. Man, it's so good to have you on, dude.
You too, buddy.
I mean,
now we could do it anytime. We're right here.
Yeah, for real. Yeah. And
you're ready for senior softball next couple of years.
Right. I'm 51 now. Okay. What is senior citizen?
55 for softball.
But
my barber, Archie's.
I go there all the time.
Okay, well, Gary Karlick runs the league. That's who I'm there.
Oh, he does?
He was waiting for me to be old enough to be in the league.
How fucking funny is that place, man? Yeah, I mean,
they don't know they're cool or rockabilly. They're just plain old.
When you sit down in there, it is exact to a barbershop in the 40s or 50s. Yeah. They're only talking politics. Fuck this guy, that guy, whatever. I know what's going on.
Or baseball.
Or baseball, yeah.
And they're not trying to be cool or rockabilly. Or they don't have a leopard skin couch. They don't even...
Not at all. My guy's Nick there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Nick.
Nick and Carmen does me, and then Gary is the boss.
Oh, yeah.
And Gary runs the baseball league.
How fucking great is that place, right? But, you know, last I got a a haircut in St. Mark's Place last month. I go to New York like every other month. And now I'm hooked on this guy there, man, because I walked in and I remember, I go, yeah, I just want to tie it up here like, you know, Nick's cut. And he goes, yeah, you know, why fuck around with that? Just take it down to Joe Strummer. And when he said that, I went, this is my guy. And he just gave me this incredible haircut in like 9 minutes.
See, those guys don't know anything like that.
No, yeah,
like,
Joe Strummer.
You know, maybe they would know, you know the Smokey and the Bandit, you know, men's hairstyling is where they
come
from.
Yeah, give me the
I went and asked for Elvis, and they didn't really know how to do it. I had to, you know, coach them along a little bit.
Really?
Yeah,
it's just a haircut. I love it, man. Yeah, this is, it's got some gems like that,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, that you could just wander into.
Those guys are old as fuck, man. I mean, they're old. They're like 80 and shit, dude. Isn't that cool to be like up and alive and working at 80?
I stop in there once in a while. I mean, if I'm driving past and there's a parking spot there, I pull in, I say hello, I sit down in the chair not being used, and it's like, I don't know if I could really do that at some trendy, like, Rockabilly on Purpose place.
Rockabilly on Purpose.
They just don't know, and they're fantastic. I like being a fly on the wall there.
Are you married?
No, not now.
No, I mean, you used to be married, right? To like a movie star.
I was married to Britt Eklund for a long time, yeah.
What did she do?
She's been in 100 movies. She was in, you know, famously a Bond girl.
Oh, Bond girl.
Yeah, Man with the Golden Gun was her one.
Which Bond?
Man with the Golden Gun.
Oh, wow.
And that's my son's mom. And we're all very close and,
Yeah, wild, right on, man.
Everything's cool, really.
You got a Twitter, of course. And Instagram?
Official Slim Jim for all of them.
Yeah. And what drums are you playing? Gretsch or what brand?
Gretsch, yeah. Right. Big time. Gretsch forever, really. Fred Gretsch, my buddy.
That is awesome, man. I love you, dude. And those records, I listened to it today at the gym, and it just took me right back, man. Rumble in Brighton is just, I mean, you know, it just takes me right back to that fucking Us Festival, man. That hot day on in the desert, waiting for the Clash to go on. They're fighting for money, you know.
I saw the whole thing.
Oh yeah, you remember
I just
that?
Witnessed it. Yeah, I sat in a road.
The Clash will not go on until they pay us in cash.
Well, I think it was more to it than that. You know?
Yeah,
but that was our day. He took a helicopter, had a new suit, you know, and it was one of those kind of, you know, that was our day. That was our day.
It really.
You know? And you know, I still see Mick J. Speak to him. And
you do?
Yeah. You know, I'm in London. We all seem to, you know, wind up at the same party or something. They're all great. I you know, I really dug those guys.
I saw Big Audio Dynamite a couple years ago at the Roxy.
Just
they
great.
They destroyed it.
Just great.
They were smoking, dude. Yeah. I mean, I thought I was going to go for a couple songs. I go, oh, I got to do comedy. Yeah. I'm going to go for a couple songs and then get out of here. I blew my set off, which I never do. And I was like, I am not going anywhere. This is fucking fire. You know? If you play, please hit me up. I want to come
see.
Yeah,
well, you got to come hike with us.
I will. Where do you hike around here?
We hike in Franklin Canyon.
Oh, I don't know it. All right.
Turn me on.
I'm in. All right.
Past Andy Griffith's Pond.
Thanks for bringing your dog. Yeah. He is so cool. Yeah. Man, what kind of dog is it, you think?
I think he's part Chihuahua, part Dachshund, maybe a little bit Pitbull in there.
God, he's got such a cool color and look.
He's like a flyweight boxer, isn't he?
Yeah.
He's like 100% muscle.
He looks like he hikes for sure.
And I found him on the street. He was about the size of a hamster. He wasn't going to make it. He was malnourished and abandoned and just took him home.
Yeah.
And now he comes everywhere with me. He's like this.
Does he go on the road with you?
No. That's...
You got to get that vest, that fake vest.
But he stays with me. We have a little kind of compound up there, and my son's there and his girlfriend. And, you know, I think it's a little cruel to take him on the road, maybe. But here in L.A., he comes everywhere with me. And
that's great. You're a baseball guy. I'm Yankees.
Yeah,
I see your pen.
Yeah.
American League. I'm not an American League guy, but...
Who's your team?
Giants.
Okay.
Yeah, San Francisco. I'm a National League.
That's kind of another thing where I used to be like, Red Sox, Yankees.
Yeah.
Now, anyone who likes baseball is totally cool with me.
Yeah.
Any team. We do fantasy baseball. We do CDs. So it's like always in a part of my life. Ever since I was a kid, I'm a baseball card guy. Even in the days of... squat houses and, you know, punk rock, you know, living and being on the road, I somehow followed baseball.
Wow.
Through international newspapers, 4 days late, whatever, you know, like I still always followed baseball. Brian's a baseball guy too, not as insane as me, but like we were, I just went to see the Yankees. I went down to Anaheim, 4 hours in traffic just to see the Yankees play. And, you know, we go to Dodger Stadium a few times a year, and it's just, I don't know.
Yeah. I went to the new Mets field. I saw Dead & Co. And, you know, the new Mets field, it's funny because what I love about old school baseball, now I love the new field. I'm not going to fucking knock
it.
Yeah,
you have to. Shea Stadium was pretty bad.
Yeah, yeah. But what I'm trying to say is, they've got the same guy that's designing them all now.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, Giant Stadium, Petco in San Diego.
Yeah, fantastic.
Hershey Park. They're fantastic, but they're all starting to feel the same now, where in the old days, you're at the Houston Astrodome.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
No one could hit a home run out of here.
Yeah, yeah.
Or you're at fucking, you know, Oakland Coliseum, or you're at shit, you know,
down to the owners, I guess. Charlie Finley wouldn't spend the bread.
Right. But it was like really... home field advantage.
Candlestick for you, right?
Candlestick, man, with the wind blowing.
Willie Mays might have topped 714 if it wasn't...
Oh, man, the wind and shit. And they had the Cyclone home run fence. That was weird. It was like Cyclone fence.
See, we should do a whole show about... I mean, I could talk about 70s baseball for...
Yeah, yeah. All that, man.
Forever.
The fucking, you know, Raleigh Fingers and the A's with the crazy stretch outfits.
Name the whole team. And I... a guy who was a... favorite of mine was your shortstop guy named Chris Spire.
Oh, Chris Spire. Holy shit,
because
he was a
superstar. Because I had him in
my
Stratomatic League. Did you ever play Stratomatic?
No.
It was pre-fantasy baseball. A game had cards and dice and, you know.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But Chris Spire, remember that fucking guy? I forgot all
totally
about
do.
That,
I...
man. You know, I met Rod Beck's like nephew or something at one of my games or gigs, and he gave me a signed Rod Beck card.
Oh,
man,
see, I love all that stuff. I still have my baseball cards and
everything. Have you been to the new Yankee Stadium?
Yes.
May you like it?
Yes.
Right.
I took my daughter there, who's like 21, and well, back then she was in her teens, but she's like a punk rocker, ultra cool kid, and like she was great. She went along with me.
Yeah,
I went to see her at college in New York, and she came with me to Yankee Stadium. We took the train uptown, went to Monument Park. I got a little bit weepy in front of Joe DiMaggio's one, and she hung with me. It was great. Yeah.
I got to go to the old park when I was on tour of the Wallflowers, and Giambi was on the team at the time.
He was cool, right?
And he got us on the field and got us these hats, and we went to Monument, you know, back out there in that left field or whatever. I think it was left field. They had those.
Yeah,
we were on the field, dude. It was crazy to be there. Yeah,
good for you. Any baseball guy is okay with me.
All right, man. Thank
nice
you so much.
You.
Thank you so
I'm
much
go
for
over
doing
there and get my mail.
All right, thanks. There he is, man. Follow him on Twitter. And go back and listen to the Stray Cat Records, man, and just and go see them live when they come out. And get the book, man. Get that book. Thanks for tuning in, guys. Leave a review and subscribe on iTunes. Thank you.